In this lesson, we're going to be talking about the classification of refrigerants. Now, refrigerants all have brand names like Freon and other things like that, the different manufacturers, but the true word of them is refrigerants. Now, it's important to understand how refrigerants are made, what they do to the environment, and the classifications in terms of flammability, toxicity, and the different compounds that are in refrigerants. It's important for a number of reasons. One, you have to understand it for safety reasons. Two, it's going to be asked about on a lot of your licensing exams and your EPA examinations. So this sets the stage for safely working with and understanding how refrigerants are used. Now, refrigerants today are divided into several chemical categories. Okay, CFCs are chlorofluorocarbons. HCFCs are hydrochlorofluorocarbons. HFCs are hydrofluorocarbons. Refrigerant blends, okay, different mixes of refrigerants can be azeotropic and zeotropic. Okay, you can have HFOs, hydrofluoroolefins, and hydrocarbons. All of these are out there in today's market. They're used for different manufacturers, and they're used in different methods. Some are also going away. Okay, chlorofluorocarbons were the first halogen-based refrigerants developed over 80 years ago. Okay, besides being used as a refrigerant, CFCs have been used as what we consider blowing agents for the manufacture of insulation and packaging. Okay, what that means, CFCs have in the past been used in things like hairsprays, any cans that are under pressure where the contents come and spray out. Okay, CFC refrigerant is composed of a chlorine, a fluorine, and a carbon. Now, the key word in here that we have to be really worried about is chlorine. Chlorine is extremely bad for the environment being in the air. Okay, two popular CFC refrigerants include R11 and R12. Okay, you will not find these on the market any longer. Okay, if you find them, be very suspicious of them, and they're extremely expensive because they can no longer be manufactured. Any R12 that's left out there that's available has either been recovered, reclaimed, or sort of brought over the border from Mexico. When CFCs are vented in the atmosphere, their chlorine atoms attach to the oxygen atoms in the ozone molecules and break the ozone molecule apart. Each chlorine atom can break up as many as 100,000 ozone molecules before it's neutralized through other chemical reactions. And that exact statement shows up on EPA exams every time an EPA exam is given. So be aware that one chlorine atom can break up as many as 100,000 ozone molecules in its lifespan. The result in the reduction of ozone is an increase in ultraviolet radiation reaching the Earth. CFC refrigerants have a high ozone depletion potential, ODP, another term you need to know. ODP is ozone depletion. ODP is a numeric value assigned to the refrigerant that provides a clear perspective in the amount of ozone depletion caused by that refrigerant. Okay, the ODP scale has a minimum value of 0 and compares the destructive potential of different chemicals. Okay, R11 is 1 on the ODP scale. By international development, they have not been manufactured in developed countries since about the end of 1995. CFCs can still be found in some air conditioning and refrigeration equipment produced before 1995. So be very careful when you are looking at nameplates of equipment. Find the year manufactured. If it's before 1995, it is possible that you have a CFC in it. Do not mix it. Okay, and these diagrams sort of show you what happens with the ozone layer. Okay, the one on the left, the sun puts off ultraviolet radiation. Okay, the ozone layer, which is made up of 3 oxygen molecules. Okay, it's O3, 3 oxygen atoms. Okay, protect the Earth from the ultraviolet radiation. As the CFCs react with the O3, which is ozone, it actually creates oxygen, but it takes away from the ozone layer, makes it thinner, and more ultraviolet radiation reaches the Earth. And UV radiation will kill plant life, kill crops, harm eyes, and everything else. It's an extremely dangerous thing to have hitting the earth at all times. Now, the next step in the refrigerants, as we became aware of the ozone depletion potential of the CFCs, was the creation of HCFCs. HCFCs are hydrofluorocarbons. They're refrigerants that are composed of hydrogen, chlorine, fluorine, and carbon. The HCFC molecules include halogens combined with either methane or ethane. Okay, examples of HCFC refrigerants are R22 and R123. Now, the importance of the green cylinder on the left is that is what's in the majority of air conditioning systems in residential and commercial right now. However, new supplies of R22 are severely limited because they are phasing them out of production. Studies have indicated that the HCFC refrigerant and refrigerant blends have less impact on the ozone layer than the fully halogenated CFCs. However, they still have chlorine in it. Okay, hydrofluorochlorofluorocarbons, that second C is still chlorines. Okay, CFC refrigerant is considered fully halogenated because of all the hydrogen atoms in the original methane. Okay, HCFCs are considered to be partially halogenated because not all of the hydrogen atoms have been replaced by chlorine and fluorine. So if you look at the chemical makeup, okay, you can actually see the difference in the three types of refrigerants that are out there. CFC is the one on the left, R11, has chlorine. You'll see that there's three chlorine molecules there. Okay, the one in the center is my HCFCs. We still have chlorine, okay, but we now have hydrogen in there as well. The one on the right, which is the HFC, which is at this point the most safe for our environment because it has no chlorine in it. Okay, we don't know yet what everything else in there does because it's still relatively new, but we do know that there's no chlorine. HCFC refrigerants tend to break down in the lower atmosphere and cause less ozone depletion than the CFCs do. Now, the trade-off is that HCFCs linger in the atmosphere and has a higher GWP. GWP is the initials for global warming potential. The GWP ratio is based on the warming effects of a substance compared with the warming effect of carbon dioxide. Now, the EPA at this time, and of course things may change, requires a complete phase out of HCFC refrigerants by the year 2030 because of the global warming potential. Now, this chart, which I urge you to refer back to, you don't have to really memorize this, with the exception of that R12 has an ODP of 1, and the HFCs have an ODP of 0, okay? And R600 is carbon monoxide, which has a GWP of 3. You can see the different types and the effect on the environments. CFCs are extremely dangerous to the ozone layer, but they're less dangerous to the global warming potential. HFC refrigerants are refrigerants that contain hydrogen, fluorine, and carbon. They're different from the CFCs and HCFCs because they do not have chlorine atoms. An example of the HCFCs are the 134A and the 404A. Now, the 134A you need to be aware of because that is what's found in motor vehicle air conditioning systems. It's what we're using a lot of refrigeration systems now. And it is available in small cylinders to buy through auto parts stores and general retail stores, even though you as an HVAC technician need to pass an EPA exam to purchase larger quantities. Okay. Even though HFCs have an ozone depletion potential zeros, some have an extremely high GWP and are being replaced by a variety of lower GWP alternatives such as carbon dioxide, hydrocarbons, and hydrofluoroolefins, HFOs. HFOs are similar to HFCs because they contain hydrogen, fluorine, and carbon, but they're slightly different due to their chemical structure. Now, Blends are something very important to be aware of. Refrigerant blends is a mixture of two or more established refrigerants. That doesn't mean you as a technician go and mix a little bit of that, a little bit of that. They have to be done in a factory environment. Okay. Based on their thermodynamic properties, they're split into three groups: azeotropic, zeotropic, and near azeotropic. Refrigerant blends fall into the same chemical classifications as individual refrigerants, which they're composed of. If a refrigerant blend has a CFC, it's a CFC. If a refrigerant blend has an HFC and an HCFC, but no CFC, then it's an HCFC. In other words, we use the harshest classification for blends that contain one or more different classifications. Some refrigerants that are commonly blended into these are R12, R22, and R134A. Azeotropic and refrigerant blends are blends that respond to changes in pressures and temperatures like a single refrigerant. Okay, they have a fixed boiling and condensing point at a pressure. Azeotropic refrigerants maintain constant properties during all operational conditions. At atmospheric pressures, these refrigerants will not separate as the blend evaporates and condenses. Okay, the separation or the fractionation of refrigerants is what we're worried about in blends. Remember, every one of these refrigerants that's mixed together has a different boiling point at a different pressure. So as the pressure drops, the components of refrigerant blends have a tendency to boil off and evaporate at different points. The azeotropic mixes do not do this. Azeotropes can be identified as their ASHRAE classification numbers are 500 series. So R500 consists of R12 and 152A. R502 consists of R12 and 115. Okay, so the 500 series is all azeotropes. Zeotropic blends are refrigerant blends in which individual refrigerants that make up the blend respond differently to conditions based on its individual characteristics. Zeotropes operate under a range of boiling and condensing points that correspond to the range of its individual refrigerant and the percentage that each refrigerant of the blend makes up. So R12 and R22 boil and condense at same pressure temperature point. Zeotropes boil and condense at different temperatures. The difference in boiling and condensing temperatures is due to fractionation. During a refrigeration cycle, a single zeotropic refrigerant can separate into its individual components. So, for example, with a zeotropic blend, if a refrigerant system has a leak, okay, you cannot just throw more of the zeotrope refrigerant into it to recharge it. You actually have to recover all the refrigerant out of it and basically replace it with fresh version refrigerant because you don't know which portion of the blend has boiled off and leaked out. The separating of these refrigerants into their own individual refrigerants is called fractionization. Fractionization can be thought of the refrigerant splitting up or fractionating into its base components. This occurs because the refrigerants in azeotropic blends have different boiling points. The refrigerant with the lowest boiling point will boil off first. The temperature at which the liquid zeotrope refrigerant first begins to boil is called the bubble point. That is a term you have to know. The bubble point is when a zeotrope first begins to boil off. So, for example, R401A is a zeotrope refrigerant composed of R22, R152A, and R124. At atmospheric pressure, R22 has a boiling point of negative 41 degrees Fahrenheit, and R152A has a boiling point of negative 13, and R124 has a boiling point of 10.5 degrees. So, obviously, the R22 is going to boil off first, then the R152A, and then the R124. As the refrigerant enters the evaporator, remember, we have a pressure drop as the refrigerant comes through the metering device and enters the evaporator. The R124 the R22 is going to vaporize first, then the R152A. At the temperature which vapor zeotrope first begins to condense is called the dew point. That happens in the condenser. The impact of fractionization is that a zeotrope refrigerant can have different temperatures at any given pressure, depending on whether it's a liquid or vapor. You will see a gap in your temperature pressure charts on this. This temperature difference is called the temperature glide. Temperature glide is the difference between the vapor and the liquid state during the evaporation and condensation at a constant pressure. The common range for temperature glide is 3 to 10 degrees Fahrenheit. Never attempt to make your own mix of refrigerants. Azeotropic and zeotropic are patented refrigerants, and the manufacturing process is complicated. You cannot just mix these things together. Okay, do not ever mix refrigerants. Near azeotropes react similar to zeotropes, but they respond over a smaller range of boiling and condensing point. Near azeotropes are technically zeotropes, but allowing them their own category helps to differentiate them more precisely. Hydroolefin is a new category of refrigerants. They're composed of hydrogen, fluorine, and carbon, but they have at least one double bond between the carbon atoms. HFO refrigerants are technically HFCs, but are made from olefins rather than alkylenes. HFOs have zero ODP and lower GWP values. HFOs are beginning to be used in automotive air conditioning. HFOs are mixable with polyester lubricants and not soluble in mineral oils or alkylbenzene lubricants. The two most popular HFOs right now are 1234YF and 1234ZE. These refrigerants have a very low toxicity but are slightly flammable, and they have an ASHRAE safety classification of A2L. The L means lower flammability. HFO 123YF is being used as a low GWP replacement for 134A in automotive air conditioning. HFO 1234ZE is designed to replace R410A in residential and light air conditioning and heat pump applications. It can also be used in air-cooled and water-cooled chillers in supermarkets and commercial buildings. It is an energy efficient and requires minimal retrofitting for existing equipment. HC refrigerants are also starting to be used. A hydrocarbons are organic substances that contain carbon and hydrogen. These substances are the components in petroleum and natural gas. HC refrigerants have an ASHRAE safety classification of A3. Okay, only some HC refrigerants has been approved by SNAP, which is a terminology for significant new alternative policy. Okay, we got to be worried about these because they are sort of flammable. SNAP is an EPA program that evaluates and regulates substitutes for high ODP refrigerants. HC in new equipment is under limited conditions, such as smaller refrigerant charges. Most of the equipment includes standalone retail refrigerators, freezers, domestic refrigerators, and freezers. Okay, this is a list of HCs that have been approved. R600, which is isobutene. R290, which is propane, and R441A, which is an HC blend. Now, you'll notice here that these things are flammable. I mean, propane has a pretty large flammable makeup. So just be careful if you see these. You cannot use your standard recovery and charging equipment on these refrigerants. So again, this is why you have to be aware of the refrigerants and what they're made of. Okay, we have refrigerants that are toxic. We have refrigerants that are flammable coming out as a replacement to the harmful refrigerants. So it's sort of a trade-off. We had stuff that was extremely safe and easy to work from a personal perspective thing, but was bad for our ozone layer. Then we have slowly migrated to refrigerants that might be great for the ozone layer, do not have a lot of global warming potential, but are now more and more dangerous for you as the potential technician to be working on.